This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive, and I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it, and when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper talk this is.
Okay, next up, Dave Larsen. He's getting mic'd up here. Scotty's queuing up his presentation. Dave's is also another submitted paper. It's presented, it's printed and available in the proceedings that you received. So Dave Larsen, KV0S, development and design of firmware programming tools for the open HPSDR hardware.
So some of you may have heard my voice before. I've been running a weekly webnet for probably about 6 or 8, 7 years now, and I do the roll call on that net, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But what I wanted to do was give you a little history of my background, how I got into working with OpenHPSDR, and what all the tasks that I've done, and then talk about some of the software design and how we have evolved over the years, and kind of an indication where we're going. First off, I'm a professor of forestry. That's my profession. I work on forest and dynamics. I build growth models of how trees grow. I develop statistical procedures for analyzing data. I do a lot of coding for somebody in a forestry field. I come from a Unix, Linux programming background. And my son, who is an electrical engineer, says that I like to collect computer languages. I was first licensed in 1975, then life happened, and I didn't do much ham radio for a number of years. I was relicensed in 2004. I found this is a common scenario. And I went to a Dayton talk in 07, got to meet Phil Harmon, got to meet Alexis, the guy in Canada, C.W. Skimmer, Alex, and a number of people, and I said, and actually got to meet Scotty, and was quite enthralled with the project, and I thought, this might be something worth getting involved in. So my first DCC was Chicago in 08, and while I was there, Scotty said, hey, could you run our website? And I said, yes. And so I've been involved. I've been doing that since that date. So that got me started being actually more active in the project. And I just told you that. I also run the TeamSpeak sessions, and that's where you may hear my voice. And it's interesting. It's every Friday night, and I've been doing it now for many, many years, and I don't miss very many. I did miss last night, but and those are recorded and posted on Ham SDR website. So, and it usually get about 100 people listening to them weekly. I also got involved in dealing with the repositories, and for years we've kept all our code on an SVN. Recently, because of changes, Jeremy McDermott at Tapper said, we're going to shut down the SVN, so we're going to move to GitHub. And it was no big problem for me, because I run GitHub at work all the time, but I realized it was actually a learning curve for quite a few of the other people in the project. So we went through some fits and starts with shifting over to the GitHub that Tapper supports. I also support this website, and originally it was just plain old HTML. I've automated a number of things in the website using a lot of PHP. It goes out and fishes stuff from other places to make the functionality. The problem is with an open source project, you have people changing stuff all the time. And I didn't want to be the only person that changed a link or a update. So I told people, you put your stuff here, and I will grab whatever you put there. And so that way, it distributed the background so that it was a lot less day-to-day work for me. I tend to like to automate things as much as possible. This website has been confusing for people, and I want to tell you a little bit about why I did it the way I did it. As a deference to Dale, the fellow who set it up, I keep the design basically the same as he set up. We've made some changes, but it does have downloads over here and some support files. Some of those are up to date. Some of them are fairly old. Remember, we're a group of people. We're not an official organization. We just people who participate. And the author of any piece of material is the responsible party for that piece of material. There's nobody. So they can propose a project. They can add the project here. And then if they get tired of it and leave it, we maintain what they did in case somebody comes along and wants to pick up the project and continue on with it. Or as just a historical record of the past. And the thing is that's confusing when you want to know what's new, what am I going to, I want to get involved, what's there. There's this kind of overwhelming mass of information. But I come at it from an academic point of view that I want to document all the wonderful work that's been done, even if it isn't complete. The other thing that we have is there is a link over here for videos, and we have a number of HPSDR videos that go back to 07 linked on there, as well as a list of journal publications that have been available from people in our group. And that I just told you about. So the first boards that we had go back in that 07 period. We had a backplane board and a Janus board, which I think Tapper still has lots of these. Yeah. So if you want a Janus board, you're welcome to get one. But they were basically a sound support board for SDR 1000. So instead of buying a sound card box, you could use this, and it would be a link into an SDR 1000. Actually, that board, while it doesn't function as a sound card, has a number of interesting capabilities, but nobody's gone back to rediscover those. And then we used the Osmuth board, which was a USB interface with a Cyclone 2, and it loaded its firmware every time you turned it on. So that was the kind of template when I started getting involved in the project. Then we decided the project first did a transmitter because it helped kind of figure out how things work. So we made a digital up converter, half watt, called Penelope. There was a legacy in the group that we like Greek names. So most people are using Greek names, but there are exceptions like LPU. And it was a Cyclone 2. It initially was programmed with a USB blaster and a Cortex programmer. And it could use either JTAG or Flash, depending on how you wanted to deal with it. Then we built Mercury, which was our first receiver, and it was a 0 to 65 megahertz, had a Cyclone 3 on it. Initially, it was programmed, again, with a USB blaster, and that made our first board set, which is, the picture of this is on the website, and this is back about, was it 210 or 209 or 210 when we developed this. So this history is important to the way that the programmer, which I'm going to tell you about, was developed. You notice at this point, there was no programmer software that was used to do anything. You either use QRDIS or everything was connected with USB and it basically was a system that was more or less self-contained. Well, we had problems with the USB 2 and it was bandwidth limited. We also had lots of driver issues and we just really didn't want to deal. We asked several times if anybody would volunteer to write a driver for our set so that we could be open source completely, and we got no takers. Nobody wanted to write USB drivers. So, and it's not a small task. And so we went on to, we did know about USB 3 at that time, but it wasn't widely available. There weren't a lot of computers that would carry it, and it actually took several years before it became generally available and widely used. We decided to try Ethernet. All the computers we had Ethernet drivers on them. They were fairly stable, used a lot, so we thought we'd try that. That came to the point where we came up with a Metis board. And the Metis board was an Ethernet interface, originally built at 100 megabit, and then with the capability of being run at gigabit, but initially we didn't do that. And it required just basic TCP kinds of interfaces. But again, in our effort to be open source, the TCP code in the FPGA was hand-built by Phil Harmon. Many FPGA companies will give you an interface package and you can use it, but it's not open source. And we wanted to stay in the open source world. So he wrote it. Now, Phil was not an FPGA programmer when he started. He wanted to learn how it worked. We happened to have, what was Kurt's last name? Weekman, who was a professional FPGA programmer from Oregon. And he gave us a very nice course on how to do that. And that's still on our website. If you ever want to go watch the videos, the whole thing is on there. And it's a little dated, but not that bad. It's within the last 10 years. So, and it was how to org. When you program Verilog, you have to think in a very different way than when you're writing C, although the code seems similar at face value. So that brought about that we had to do some things to actually add updates to the boards, because we couldn't then just suck through the internet every time that you turn the board on. So the idea was, let's make a set of tools that would let, so you didn't have to get the entire QRDIS software suite, which takes about a 3-hour download. Huh? QRDIS is the programmer set from Altera, which programs the Cyclone boards and a few other boards. So, and Scotty has written some nice articles about using some of these and dealing with some of the issues. So we had to build a couple of things. One was we wanted a way that if you wanted to put the firmware into the FPGA, so it originally was built in a QRDIS, you compile it, and you could do it with that. And those of us that work in this a lot, we did it quite a lot. But it was also quite onerous for end users to do that. So if people wanted to update, we needed a way that you could do that. So the first thing that we did is we said, well, let's build something that would do this, and The first program fell to John Melton, an English programmer, who's done a lot of nice work for our, in our project. And he decided to use PCAP protocol. So PCAP protocol is a Mac-based addressing system. And most of you, the most common place you'd see PCAP protocol is using Wireshark, because Wireshark uses PCAP protocol. The library is freely available in the Linux system. There is a Windows version of it that has been used, that we use. And it allows you not to have to have the TCP stack to be able to stick something in the board. And one of the nice things that we figured out was we could take the Metis board, change the firmware, and turn it into a JTAG programmer. And then use the JTAG programmer to program the Penelope board and the Mercury board that we already had, so that you didn't need to go buy a USB blaster to load those. You see, this is a kind of a complicated web of pieces, but we were trying to make the hardware and firmware that we had and the software work with basically the parts that we already had that were part of the radio system. So we built a basic beginning programmer, and John called that HPSDR programmer. Now, HPSDR programmer did a number of things, and it was written in C++ using a Qt interface. But the workflow in the software was such that people didn't know which thing they needed to do unless you were one of us that does it all the time. So it was a kind of software that if you knew what you're doing, it was very handy and you could do exactly what you want. But if you didn't know what you were doing, it was very hard, and you didn't have anybody to ask, it was very hard to figure it out on your own. And it worked fine, it still works fine, and many people use that original software because it continues to work fine. So, I just told you that. This is the point where I started. So I had been doing this web stuff, and while I can do web stuff, I maintain web things at work, I decided I wanted to do something more than that. So I volunteered to deal with this programmer issue. So the first thing I did is broke the programmer into two pieces. So one was a program I called HPSDR bootloader. I think. And we're separating the PCAP recovery functions, and we're adding a UDP programming function. So here's how this works. The bootloader program is a program for recovering from programming failures. And so short of this, you have to go back to the Quartus programmer and start from scratch. And the HPSDR programmer that I wrote was to take normal updates and just put them in the radio and be much simpler. So the design criteria were for the original recovery, the HPSDR bootloader program. It used PCAP, which is a Mac addressing. It requires that when you're running it, you have to be an administrator on the machine. So you cannot run it as a user. And it also requires that you set jumpers on the board. Now, people who had put, with the old Atlas set, most of it was out in the open, except for when you put it in John's nice little box. So it wasn't too hard to move a jumper on the board. But when we went to the next single board version of our radio, It was in a single board, and a lot of people wanted to put that in a box. But that also meant the jumpers were inside the box, so you had to take the box apart to get to the jumpers. Now, if you're like me, I simply put a switch on the jumper and ran it to the outside so I could go back and forth, because I program these boards lots and lots of times. So these were impediments for people who were casual updaters of their boards. The other thing, and there was one other thing. This programmer is necessary if you're going to JTAG program any of the other boards, or you have to have a USB blaster to program those boards. So that's the one other capability that has to be done with the bootloader. And here's the basic flow diagram of the board. You have the bootloader. It will talk to basically a Metis or a Hermes. It has a different jumper, but they basically are the bootloader jumper. You can go JTAG to Metis and use that to program Mercury, or use that to program Penelope. Angelias can also be, and that was the start of when we were up to Hermes. Most all these boards were built as a project from Tapper. And then at the Hermes point, we had a commercial vendor that was very aggressive about using this software. And remember, we're an open source, open license hardware and software. And this vendor started selling the Apache Labs set of radios and basing it on these designs. So, interestingly, I've never actually used one of those radios, but my software works on their stuff. And people let me know when it doesn't work. But then I have to ask them, will you test this and tell me if it fixed your problem? Because I don't own those radios. So here is the basic HPSDR bootloader in the C++ Qt interface. The first thing you have to do is decide what interface you're going to use, what network interface. And in the original code, I maintained this from John Melton, you have to select an interface. Then it will tell you the MAC address and the IP address of that radio, even though it's using PCAP, so it's basically using this MAC address. Then it tells you you have this MAC address found. There is a button to make if it doesn't find one. So first you find an interface, then you find, is there a bootloader software on your network? Then you tell it, here's the code that I want to put into the device. You browse for it, then program it. If you have a Hermes, you're done. If you have a Metis, you're done for the Metis. And if you want to program a Penelope or a Mercury, you then go down here and interrogate to see if in the JTAG chain there is a Mercury or a Penelope. There is one little trick. We found that for reliability, it is best to put your Mercury in the last port of the Atlas board, the furthest from the power supply, and then put the board you wish to program in the second port, and put a last JTAG jumper on that board, and then it seems to work very much more reliably that way. So this is the bootloader software. Again, you need to be an administrator, you need to set jumpers, and it's also needed if you want to do this JTAG programming. Then we had this other idea that we could come up with an easier way to update firmware. We decided since the radio uses UDP, we would like to use UDP. That eliminates the need for being an administrator, and it eliminates the need to set a jumper. we put into firmware at a certain date. I forget the actual number. It was around 1.6 or somewhere in there. So there is bits of code in the firmware that will listen to a request from this new piece of software to change the code. It does a discovery. So it does a discovery just like you're turning on the radio. It finds the board. The firmware, the old firmware, is running in the FPGA. That old firmware talks to this program, and you say, I'm going to send you new firmware. The new firmware comes and is written into the flash memory. If everything works right, you unplug the power, plug it back in, and it will, the flash will then load into the FPGA, and you're in the new version. Now, when we were building this, we didn't think a lot about double checks and security. So when we wrote the radio code just throws UDP packets and really doesn't worry if they ever get anywhere. And that's a problem when you're sending firmware to the flash memory. And so this became one of the impetus. So we had a lot of problems with the programmer getting partway through the programming process and then just hang or go off. And then if that happened, you had no viable code in the flash memory to start up the radio, and people go, oh, my radio's ruined. And it isn't really ruined. You just go back a step and use the bootloader software. And out of radio, I think there's only one board that I've never been actually able to recover. And I think you had a few, but not very many. So this was a simpler. And it worked pretty nice if everything worked right. So it would just basically, the old firmware would load the flash memory, then the flash memory reboot, and then away you'd go for the next version. And it didn't require any connector changes inside on the board. And it basically worked this way. And here's one of those legacy things. It would work with, there are numbers in there that you have a Metis, a Hermes, an Angelia, or a Griffin. How many of you have ever heard of a Griffin? George does back there. Griffin was a small project that we were playing with Phil on essentially beaconing. And it kind of fell by the wayside. So then, the simplified interface is this. You still had to select your network interface. You had to select which board, but you could have multiple boards on the interface or the network subnet. And you could select that. You could do it in the discovery, and it would actually discover multiple boards, and then you could select which one you were going to program. And then you gave it the RBF file, and it would do this process that I was telling you. The problem is, if it stopped in the middle, we had no way to debug what was going on, or why it did it, or what was going on. So that leads to our next step. So that for about 3 years, I didn't change this code at all. And it seemed to continue to work right, except for this problem of incomplete programming. And the problem was not that I couldn't fix it. I couldn't fix it with the old protocol. We had to change something in the way the radio worked to have a way to fix things. And also in the process, because of lots of people touching the code, code can accumulate detritus. most of you that are programmers understand this. So the other thing that I ran across was I would compile the code. I could compile the code pretty easily, but particularly on Windows, I had to use a Windows Wix installer, and it changes over time. And I had one that was working just fine. I was able to produce Wix files, and I waited 2 years, and it was like it was a whole new world. I didn't know what was going on. So the Linux wasn't too bad. The Mac wasn't too bad. But so all these issues led to our next step. And I decided, well, first off, this is my hobby. I don't work for anybody to do this. I just do it for fun. This, while you may be making contests in a contest, I like making code that works on these radios. So this is my hobby. So I like to do things that I find interesting. So I thought, well, let's start over. Let's work in a language where I can do a more thorough job of testing the algorithms, and let's work in a way that's cleaner and a little easier to use. So one of the things, I happened to be at work learning this program. The name of the program is Go. It goes by, on the net, if you type Go, you'll get a lot of different things. But if you type Golang, you'll get this web page. This is an open source language, and it has this address, golang.org. It was originally invented at Google. And it was a closed project for a couple of years till they defined enough of a language that it was functional. And then they open sourced it, and actually Google staff only built the Linux and the Mac versions. The Windows version is completely community-driven. This also runs on Solaris. It runs on an IBM mainframe. It runs on an ARM, both in 32-bit or 64-bit for any of them. So literally, I can use my Raspberry Pi to program the board if I want to with my code. So it has some great advantages. It is C flavored. So if you're a C programmer, it doesn't look that strange. First developed, and the three original developers are these guys, and you may have heard of some of these people before. If you have ever paid attention to Bell Labs, you know, Ken Thompson wrote the language B, the predecessor of the language C. He also wrote an operating system called Plan 9. And then Rob Pike wrote the Unix programming language manual for Bell Labs. He was an author on it with other people. One of the ones he wrote with Dennis Ritchie. So these are people, and what had happened is these guys were at the end of working at Bell Labs, and then Google hired them and said, and this project was not a directed project from Google. At Google, they give them what they call 20% projects. So they allow them to work one day a week on whatever they want to. And this programming language was a 20% project by these guys. So, and I think, Ken Thompson, these are the things he did. I just told you that. Rob Pike, the other interesting thing is Rob is the author of UDF-8, which, if you don't know, is like ASCII that will work with any language you want, so you don't have English bias. And so, and Rob worked on Sawzall and has some C background, and he had more of a Smalltalk type of programming background. They were also influenced by this paper. And so the Go language is heavily based on the ideas in this paper by Hoare, which is communicating sequential processes, which is the idea that you don't want to build a parallel programming system where you're locking things all the time. You're just basically sending messages back and forth. And this is the philosophy. So it makes something that is like threads that are incredibly easy to build and save and use. So other features in Go that I particularly like is it has a built-in section for testing. So testing allows you to build, write a function, and then write a test at the same time. And then you just go test, and it runs all your tests on all your functions. You don't only use it while you're building the software, but every time you move it to a new compiled platform, you run the test again, make sure it still works, which is a really nice feature. And right now, if you go to the Golang page that I showed you, you will see this kind of big matrix of all the different machines that it compiles on and which machines are having failures. And because they're basically, every time they submit to their repository, it runs all the tests. And so you can see, well, that change broke this thing over here. And that's a really nice feature. Also, the language came with built-in PCAP and UDP and HTTP libraries that make it very easy to work in all those different venues. And one thing I like, I got frustrated in the C++ code of dealing with dynamic libraries, and particularly with Qt, it's very hard to find which library do I need. So you basically go through this little routine where you build the code, it runs in your machine, then you move it to a machine that doesn't have the libraries, and you start, and then you have to go one by one, it wants this one, it wants this one, you copy and paste it over, copy and paste it over. And I found that incredibly frustrating. So back to static libraries, you get one file, it's an executable, and you give it to somebody, and it runs. So, disadvantages of Go. There is a big disadvantage. It was written as a system programming language. And, you know, they use it on Google Clouds and Amazon Clouds and all these different platforms. It works really well in that environment, but it does not have a GUI. So you say, well, why are you doing this? We all want GUIs, right? Well, again, remember, it's my hobby. So I wanted to try using this. So I was going to rewrite the code for Protocol 2, which in Protocol 2, to fix the problem of throwing packets at the radio and not knowing if they actually got received, we started a sequencing system. And in the Protocol 2 programmers, you send a packet, and you don't continue till you get an acknowledgement that it was received. Duh. It was not a piece of rocket science to be able to know to do this, but we could not do that in Protocol 1. Yes?
Isn't that called TCP/IP?
Well, TCP/IP will tell you that the packet got to the radio, but it doesn't tell you if the radio got it in the right place in the...
But UDP should have checksums in it.
Yeah, but it doesn't, the failure was not in the transfer as much as it was in the copying process inside. It sometimes was a process, but it was very confusing. This way, we send a packet, it goes all the way through, and then the FPGA code gives an acknowledgement that comes all the way back before we send the next packet. And it really doesn't make the programming any longer. It's all very fast. So that was one of the things we did. So I decided, let's make it simple, because I spend 70% of the time writing GUI interfaces and only 30% of the time functionally working. So I said, let's just for a while work functionally. So I wrote a command line, and this is back to, you know, I started programming in the 70s. So I used to do this all the time. So this is all the same information that GUI tells you, but it's just, you run it on a command line and you have to put some switches up here. So those of you that do, particularly Linux programmers, are used to this. But I have found that many Windows programmers are not. So this, and when I first did the programming, Protocol 2 was not completely finished in writing, so I had no test bed. So I went back and rewrote the Protocol 1 version in this. And this is the programmer that will do Protocol 1. Then I started writing the Protocol 2 programmer with the protocol without a standard, without anything to test against. And when I got it done, I tried it, and it basically worked just writing off the protocol, that's very nice when you're able to do that. And here's the Protocol 2 command line programmer. Now, right now, I did them separately because I was trying to keep the code clean. But one of the first complaints I got was from some of the other developers, we need some way to look at this. And if you remember, I told you that Golang has the capability of adding web pages, web servers. So writing a web server in Golang is 3 or 4 lines. So, and I knew a lot about programming web pages from my past history of working in this project and at work. So we actually built an encapsulated website inside the program. So all the actual HTML code is strings that are embedded in the code. And so we end up building a web interface. And the way it works is you start the program, and it only runs on your machine. You're not building a web server to access the world. You're building something to access your radio. So you start it up. It'll say, go to localhost, which is just kind of the feedback inside the, and then a port number. And if you go there, you will get a page. I think this, yeah, here it is. You run the code. It says, it gives you a web address. Take any browser you want, stick it to this web address, and you'll get this. So then I have some text that tells you what we're doing, and you know there's a programmer, and you select an interface. Right now it's selecting interface. Here's a list of the interfaces on your machine. You select one of those. Then it says, we found a Hermes. So you have to select the radio that you want to program. You select that. Here's the specifications. This is the same information I was giving you in the command line or in the old program. It's just a different way of packaging it. And it was more fun than writing the same old program over and over and over. So here we have it. And then you have choices. You can change the IP address. If you want to use a static IP, that's a capability. Or you can program it. And I think my sequence does programming. So here's programming. It says, we're going to program a Hermes and choose a file for your code, the firmware that you want to put into the radio. Also, I have it with a link because it's a web page. I can put in there a link to the repository if you don't have the code, which is really a nice little feature that's trivial here and a little bit more complicated if you're inside of a enclosed program. So we upload it. It tells you, here I found this file. It has, this is the file size, this is the memory size, and how many total packets it's going to send. Then it starts running, and there's a little, this didn't really work, but it was a, I put a little JavaScript thing in there that's a counter that says, okay, because if you don't have something, this just sits there and you wonder, well, is it doing anything? And so I put in a little JavaScript counter, and then it finishes, and in the background where that you'd started the program is a log of everything you've done. So if you have mistakes or things, you send me this file, and then I have an idea what you've done. So what am I going to do next? Well, one is that basic interface thing, I want to make it where you don't have to do that. So I've worked out the code to do where it'll go through all the interfaces and see if there's any HPSDR radios in any of them, or ones that answer HPSDR, like Scotty's. And then you would go through the programming steps. So you'd have to pick the radio that you found and then put the code in. I'd like to start working on more of a programming interface, but I don't want to duplicate things that are already built. So I'm going to build a basic radio and then start trying some ideas that are different. Remember, I have a day job that I'm a professor, so I don't have a huge amount of spare time. this is mostly weekend work, but as many of us in the room, I'm at an age that I can see the end of my work life, and I plan to spend more time on some of these things. So, anyway, I think I wanted you to see that getting involved in all this went back to saying yes to something like Scotty saying, do you want to help? And any of you can contribute to these projects. These projects, there's no big master plan. It's like, I've got an idea. Are you guys interested? And we usually say yes, if it's got something to do with SDR radio. So even if you don't think you have the skill set, I get lots of people saying to me, I want this change, but I don't know how to do it. Well, that's part of our hobby. Help learn how to do things. And there are projects of all different types. I mean, you can do documentation. We always need people to write down. People say, I don't understand how this works. Well, the people that write this spend a lot of time trying to write documentation, but when they're writing documentation, they're not writing new features, new code. So the actual OpenHPSDR group, there are lots of people that contribute, but then the kind of active core is, 10 or 20 people. And several of them are in this room.
And let's wrap up, Dave.
Okay. And I think that's it.
Okay. Any quick questions for Dave?
One quick one is, if you want to look at some of you have seen this, but the Protocol 2 stuff, we have a beta website, and when the people decide it's done, then we're going to move to a slightly different looking interface for the web. We'll maintain all the old stuff.
Okay, any questions? Oh, I'm afraid they're all too hungry. Oh, Tom?
The Protocol 1 and Protocol 2 versions, are they listed separately on the web page so you can figure out which is
which? They actually are in the same zip or compressed file, but they have slightly different names so that you can understand. I am going to try to make a unified version, but I haven't done that yet.
Okay, so you just, on a command line, you just type the name of one or the other, it'll launch the...
And the way it goes.
Okay, any other quick questions?
All the code is on the GitHub repository under programmers.
Okay, big round of applause for Dave. It is lunchtime, so lunch is being held in the banquet room. Be back here ready to go at 1 o'clock.